Well, at one point, failure to drive without a license or driving without a license consists of 80% of the jail population up here, so they stopped putting people in jail for it a while back.
Okay, so you know that they stopped putting people in jail for it, but you don't know, you know, what happens after the second time of going to court and so forth with it.
And I also don't know if I go in there.
Okay.
I don't know. Now,
okay, so has the prosecutor offered you any kind of a plea deal?
Nope.
That's the strange part, okay.
No, the only time I've actually spoken with him is when he told me I needed to plead guilty or he was going to bring the charge into the criminal realm.
And he didn't tell you plead guilty and throw yourself on our mercy, or he's going to do what? Bring more charges? Is that what he said?
At the time, the charge was under traffic, and he said usually what he does when people challenge this is refile it as a criminal charge. So that's what happened, basically.
Well, that's actually a very good thing, because the criminal charges actually have a higher standard of proof. Now, of course, that brought with it probably the 3-month deal, didn't it?
That it did.
And so the judge is going to want to, give his buddy what he wants, which is to smack you down, right? How dare you put them through that work?
Yeah, and the scary part here is the judge I met the other day was just some sort of sub that rotated in. It's not a judge who's normally in that courthouse.
Why is that scary or not scary?
Because that wasn't even somebody he has lunch with on a regular basis. I can imagine
these I see what you're saying. It's like this guy should have been even more. But he knows that he won't be brought in as a sub if he's an asshole to them, right?
Right.
He knows his place in the game. It's not like he doesn't. He knows what his job is. His job is to hand them convictions.
Oh, I'm sure they all know their place in the game.
Right. All right. So you already picked your battle by not pleading guilty to the civil side of things when the punishment was probably just a fine, right?
Right. I was also found guilty with a corresponding charge during the same time, also on the traffic side of things.
So you basically said fuck y'all because of money at that point. Now you're kind of like regretting it.
Well, I said fuck y'all more because of ethics at that point, and now
fuck ethics. There is no ethics here to be found. They're talking about throwing you in jail. Ethics be damned, right? I mean, you're under the impression for justice. I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry. You had to find this truth, but no place in court, right? Other than as a political tool.
I certainly understand that.
Yeah. Well, here you are, though. All right. Right. Go ahead.
Basically, I don't like the idea of my kids growing up with the same sort of threat around them that everybody else is currently facing.
Sorry to inform you, but there are wolves in the woods. Always will be.
Got to go south of the border and get away from these particular wolves.
Well, we are thinking about moving. There's a lot of shitty homeschool laws where I'm at.
Yeah. But here you are with this. And of course, your job is one you don't want to lose.
No, it wouldn't be easily replaced. Not where I'm at.
So if you were to find out same in work, would you want to do it?
Sorry, you cut out until if I were to find out now.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I'm going down a shitty street. Hold on. It should be cleared up by now. So if you found out.
They're all shitty streets.
Ba-da-ching. Yeah, I was going down the one that always cuts out, though. So if you were to find out that every bit of time that you wanted to save off of your, you know, potential 3-month sentence would cost you the same amount of time in learning and getting your head around things, would you still want to do it?
I'm sorry, man. One more time. I just got blown up.
Right. One more time. If you found out that the amount of time you could save off of your 3-month stint, right, your potential 3-month punishment, if you found out that it took you just as much work, you know, time-wise, as it saves you, would you still want to do it?
I'm not sure your definition of work. My only
so is, he's saying for every day that you spend learning how to defend yourself, that's one less day you would have to do in jail for the 3 months. Would you do it?
Absolutely.
Did I get that
what
right?
What if it was only a chance? What if it was a 50-50 chance? You spend all 3 months doing the work, and it's still a 50-50 chance that you're still going to do the 3 months.
Well, I don't see how having to do the 3 months would stop me from doing the work.
I'm just asking you kind of like how you view this, the odds of you being found guilty. I'm still trying to probe into your optimism about being, of jail time like it was a joke.
You got Skype.
And I don't want you. Oh. I've seen judges hand people 60 days of jail like it was a joke. And I just don't want you to be caught off guard by that possibility and that, you know, the fact that you come across judges who feel that way.
Well, at this point, I mean, the only reason that I'm it'd be tough for my wife to keep the house functioning without me around.
Oh, okay. You don't understand. It's not. There's not a negotiation in this. It's like, you know, the fallout is the fallout. You know, you go to jail, it's just the fallout is already there. And I understand where your mind is going to the fallout, but that's. You have odds that you will be 3 months in jail. That is a non-zero possibility. In fact, 3 months in jail is probably still more likely than 0 days in jail. I have a tough way of gauging it, but, you know, Joe, what do you think? Do you think 0 days is as likely, more likely, or less likely than 30? Or than, not 30, but 3 months?
I'm pretty sure it's going to be a few days.
Well,
okay, but you're, yeah.
I mean, to me, it depends on him. I mean, their whole tactic, okay, as we all know, is scary, scary, big amount, give you tiny, tiny, tiny amount in the hopes that you'll be like, oh, thank you, Daddy Government. Wow, you're so nice. I got such a small shred of what I could have gotten.
Right.
But at some point in time, I mean, what we're talking about is, like I've said this before, it's kind of like a sword. It just depends on how well you swing it, whether you get the 0 or the 3 days.
Well, Joe, you mentioned the other day that 3 days would be too much for you. At that point, I can't imagine that's something you would back off on.
I'm having a hard time hearing. Did you say if they gave you a plea deal of 3 days, you'd have a hard time backing off on that one, so you'd probably take it?
No, in the chat the other day, you said, shit, 3 days was too much as far as contempt goes. How much, when they were asking me how much I was willing to do. But at that point, you would back off?
Dang it, I'm sorry. One more time.
All right. A couple days ago, we were having a chat conversation about this, and Gary asked me how many days I'd be willing to spend on contempt. And you said something to the effect of, shit, 3 days is too much, I'm out. What do you do at that point? I mean, do you start capitulating? Do you start negotiating?
Yeah, this is ultimately something only you can answer. It's just up to you. I mean, we call this consideration, lack of a better word, damage control. So, I mean, I can give you some possible options, but I'm not going to give them in a way that in any way is like, you should do this or you should do that. I mean,
I was just asking what you meant by that when you said 3 days was too much and you'd be out.
Oh, okay. I'll rephrase. All I'm saying is if they gave you a plea deal right now that said 3 days in jail, would you be like, woohoo, I'll take it? I'm trying to understand where you're coming from, not I think you're doing it wrong. I'm just really curious.
Well, after Gary's positivity that I'm going to be spending months, I would rethink it. Yeah, probably would probably take three. But still, in that time, I'm probably going to go through multiple seizures and, you know, a lot of damage is going to be done.
Okay, so we need to get a doctor involved. I remember this now. We need to get a doctor's form and a signature involved. And at the very next hearing or whatever, this needs to be presented. Because you cannot trust the jail to be, you got to tell them, oh yeah, sure, buddy, you're one of 50 inmates and half of them say they need meds. Yeah, I'll get to you. A doctor's signature holds power. And it needs to be very clear on the consequences that will happen to you. And tell the doctor write it in that way. Go ahead.
And you can even bring up the fact that, you know, historically, anyone who dares to challenge the prosecutor's standing has been met with threats of incarceration. And for you, that's a threat of physical harm.
Grave potential physical and medical harm.
And so because you cannot, you know, justice aside, risk pursuing justice with that knowledge that people have been found in contempt without cause, and that would be a death sentence, or that would be a potential death sentence to you, or a potential harm to you, you can kind of approach it from that and say, you know, and say, given that I'm actually, you know, pursuing justice is actually a threat to my livelihood, I'm considering, you know, pleading guilty if it doesn't involve jail time and that threat upon my life, you know, no matter the cost or something like that, you know.
I'd be willing to bet that most judges are going to respond with some kind of extra special. Oh, Mr. X, I guarantee you, I'm going to take this doctor's note into consideration. We're going to pass this along to the authorities. We're going to have your medication there ready and waiting. So I don't want you to try to appeal to this victim card, you know, and claim that you're not going to fully pursue defending yourself in this system of justice, blah, 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 blah. That's the only most powerful counter I can think of, but really the point that's being made is, that's nice, Judge. You'll forgive me if I don't put that kind of trust in your word when you don't work at the jail and I don't have access to you, obviously, in there.
And I would submit a motion to this effect.
I mean, you can put a motion in about anything, but what I really would want is a rock solid, airtight doctor's recommendation with a full signature MD. Like, that has power in a courtroom, given the condition that you're talking about. And then you can leverage that to help, what's the word? Influence the powers that shouldn't be to accepting a plea deal that doesn't include any jail. That's probably how I'm thinking, with the limited knowledge I have right now, how I would play it.
What do you think it would be a good idea to go get my license at this point?
To me, it's more how one goes about getting their license than just that they go and get it. I mean, I'm not going to split hairs here. I can't answer that. Like, if I were you, I probably would. I have a license. Do I like it? No. Do I have it? Yes. Why? Because I have bigger fish in life to fry than charges for not driving without a license. I mean, I've been through the ringer a few times. You know, if I'm going to go really fight on something, it's going to be on something big and worth fighting. So,
That makes sense. Do you protect yourself in any way when you get the license, or do you just grab it like anybody else? Like, I've read a lot about this UCC 1308.
Yeah, I went in there and tried that too. I don't sign it. I sign it with an X and draw a little skull above it, so it's kind of like a skull and crossbones. And
well, for one, we don't. You know, the idea of signing something makes no sense when there's a violent threat involved, anyways.
Yeah, so I autograph it.
No. Yeah. Sorry.
You know, but I mean, some battles are worth fighting and some aren't. And given your health concerns, I don't see this one worth fighting. But that, you know, I have such a limited knowledge of the entirety of your situation. Just
yeah. And if I can add about the UCC is never interpreted by U.S. judges to mean anything that the people who advocate UCC conclude. Never happened. If someone has an instance where it happened, I'd love to know about it.
Yeah. Nope, I was found guilty immediately after my testimony.
What's that?
So no, I was found guilty immediately after my testimony.
After your testimony? Okay.
Yeah, the only thing I asserted that I stipulate this clause on the end of all government contracts.
I gotcha. So you had evidence, or do you just state it? You know, again, you're trying to inspire somebody else to have an interpretation that you like. It's just weird.
I did have evidence, but I was behind the bar, and they wouldn't send
somebody. No. You had evidence of what?
Well, I'm assuming evidence that she was talking about the evidence that I signed that on my ID card.
Okay, so hold on. So you had evidence of something, you said, right? What did you have evidence of?
That I sign all my government contracts with the UCC code 1308.
And what does that mean? I mean, basically, you just told me that you sign it and then added some, you know, irrelevant, you know, stipulation, but you told me you sign your government contracts.
Well, I went on to explain that this UCC code stipulates that if there are any clauses in here that seek to replace my rights with privileges, those are now null and void, or those are null and void at the moment.
Yeah, how do you sign something and null and void vaguely some stipulation of what you signed?
I thought that's what the clause. I mean, the clause was there.
It is your job. It is your job to say if you had an interpretation that goes contrary, to be specific about your interpretation, not just say vaguely, I interpret this to mean everything I want it to mean, and not say what you mean.
How is that not clear on what I meant?
Okay, so let's go back to what you just asserted. You said that I signed this with a reservation of all your rights, right? That nothing would be converted to privileges, right? Sure, so you signed something with a reservation of all rights. Is that correct?
Yes.
Now, to sign something means to exchange rights with someone else. Right? So you're trying to create a round square. So either you signed it, or you reserved your rights. Which one do you choose?
I'm going to go with reserve my rights.
But you signed it, and you just said so.
And then I reserved my rights.
You can't do both. It's to sign something is to agree to an exchange. Do you follow that part? An agreement means that something exchanges.
Right, but wouldn't this argument, like, wouldn't this change the contract?
Well, let's get our principle down strat. To sign something means to exchange rights in some way, shape, or form, right?
Agreed, yes.
That's what it means to sign something. And then to say, I signed it, but I reserved all my rights, is trying to defraud somebody.
Would have been better off if I said I signed it and I put this code on here because basically I had a gun in my head.
Then you didn't sign it. To sign something means to agree to something. You've got to dig up that root. The root is, I agreed to something. Now, you can say, I pretended to agree to something to keep from being shot. That's one thing.
Gotcha.
But it's a very different thing to say, I agreed to it, but now I don't like that, and I want to adjust things.
No, I had the same opinion about it ever since the first time I signed it.
But you signed it! Okay, to sign something means to exchange rights. So what were you trying to do? What rights? You were trying to get things from the other party and not give up anything of yours. Is that correct? That's what it means. If I sign while reserving all my rights, it means I'm trying to defraud somebody into giving me something on the like while pretending to agree to them.
So it was my assumption, and assumption.
Okay.
What I thought was, so when you sign this after your name, I even have a stamp.
Okay.
This changes the nature of the contract.
I'm trying to figure out what you changed it to. I'm trying to get you to tell me in what way you changed it. So you're telling me so far is that you changed it to being an attempt to get them to give you what they were going to give you without giving them anything in exchange. Is that what you are trying to construct here? With this quote-unquote signature?
Without turning over any of my rights. I mean, at this point...
That's exactly what you're exchanging when you sign something. Every signature involves a relinquishment of rights in exchange for someone else relinquishing theirs.
Okay, so I went down the right to travel path for a long time.
Okay, now if you say you had the right to travel, now ethically I agree with you, but what are you exchanging then?
I'm curious. What do you mean by exchange?
You signed something, okay? A signature is an agreement. An agreement is the exchange of two bodies of rights. You're giving up something, and the other side's giving up something. You tell me what you meant to be exchanging, and I might agree with you, but you're just saying, I was just signing to get stuff from them, and not give. That's called fraud. If you're trying to get somebody else to give something up, and pretend to give you something up in exchange, but don't, that's called fraud.
Okay, so I was signing this in hopes of being left alone. Except on the rare occurrence that I might be doing business.
All right. Okay.
So I signed this way, stipulating that.
No, you can't. Okay. There's two possible positions. One is that you were just trying to exercise peacefully something you had the right to do and trying to get them to get off your back. That's one assertion. That's one kind of concept.
I like that one.
On the other hand is this kind of concept where you're giving up something and they're giving up something. You can't walk that fence between the two and try to grab benefits from both sides of this. You have to choose what your assertion is. You have to pick, are you going to contend that you had the right to travel and that it was rightful for you to travel and wrong for them to interfere and everything they did to interfere? You were just trying to counter their inference and minimize the damage they did by playing different games. That's one group of you have to, if you have that, if you take that position, you really have to take it. You can't half it.
Okay, so that was the position I was taking initially.
No, it wasn't, because you keep talking about signatures and reserving rights in those signatures. You see, that's what's killing you here.
So I should focus more on the violent nature of the person I'm signing
reality.
With.
Reality and ethics. You're not signing. If you're begging, if you're begging a mob boss not to kill your family, you're not agreeing to things. You're trying to mitigate his violence.
Understood.
Okay. Ethics are off the table. Agreements are off the table. There is no such thing as an agreement in a violent situation. You can agree, in quotes, to give a mugger your wallet, But that's not some kind of an agreement. That's like that's not a market exchange. That's not like you go to court and say, well, I agreed to give him my wallet, and then he shot me anyways. You know? My interpretation of those rights, those bills of rights, and those constitutions holds that you owe us money and time in jail. Now, thank you very much for agreeing with me on that topic. Go to jail. Because your interpretation of the Constitution is not relevant. It's his interpretation of the Constitution that matters. And do you have any reason why it wouldn't? Can you articulate a reason why the judges, this judge who answers to the Supreme Court and was appointed by, you know, plenty of people who have this great respect for the Constitution, the whole structure's there, great. He's the guy in your instance to interpret the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. Do you have any objection to him sending you to jail?
Yes.
Okay, is that objection based upon principles related to what we've discussed so far about interpreting the Constitution? Or is it a joy?
That principle would be based off of more no corpus delicti, no victim, there's no damage.
Oh, you owed them your obedience. And the fact that you failed to do so is a damage to them. According to his interpretation of the Constitution and your own words and your own value of the Constitution itself. Do you have any objection to that?
My inclination is to say yes.
Tough one, isn't it? Yeah, it's a tough one. The thing is that you're reaching to a constitution that they interpret. And they're the rightful interpreters. They can interpret it to mean the opposite of what it says. No problem at all. They can interpret the rights to mean nothing at all, as they do and have. They can interpret the obligations to be absolute. 100% of your money goes to them, and 100% of your loyalty goes to them. And there's not much you can do. There's no principle you can stand on to say, No, you're not interpreting it right. You're not doing it right. It's like, no, they're the guys to do it. If you look at the Constitution, it says who does it. And, you know, where it doesn't, you know, they interpret it that way, at least.
Well, they often ignore it. Aren't they supposed to follow the...
No, they follow to the letter. They follow to the absolute letter their own interpretation of the Constitution and the Bills of Rights. All of them. Every constitution and every bill of rights, they interpret it to the exactness of their interpretation.
So why do you, like, so why does Mark have all these, all the different case citings in his motion to dismiss?
To give them something to reach to decide to let you go. It's not right because the words say it. It's just offering them a scapegoat. It's just offering them some reason to give for letting you go. Hey, you could let us go on the pretense that this guy here was right. It's not true because some other judge said it's true. You see, those citations are there to give him an easy way to let you go. Nothing more. It's not right because some other judge said it's right, and it's not wrong because some other judge said it's wrong. So we're just trying to make it easy. No, citations help them to find in your favor if they already wanted to find in your favor. That's the only thing it's giving them. It's giving them a scapegoat. It's like, well, I want to find in your favor, but I don't know of any citations. Well, here's one. But it's right because it's right. They will instantly reverse any court if that's what they want to do. Hell, we had some court, and, you know, we had courts overturn long-standing precedents before. Little minor nobody courts overturn gargantuan findings just to, keep an immigrant you know, in the country that the president maybe wanted to send elsewhere or whatever. There's all kinds of this happening, you know. Judges overturn huge precedents all the time because they want to. I gotta step into a dollar store here for just a second. I'm gonna mute out. But even if that motion is denied, the point of the motion remains, because you're voicing your desire to be informed of the cause and nature of the proceedings in that motion to vacate a plea. And even if they leave the plea in place, the fact that you haven't been informed of the cause and nature of the proceedings still remains a problem. So the motion to vacate the plea is just a way to communicate the fact that you've not been informed of a specific point on the cause and nature of the charges. That makes sense?
You think he could sue after the fact?
Sue in what venue?
I don't know. I'm not even sure.
Oh, well, I mean, you can sue anybody. It'll be instantly dismissed, I'm pretty sure. But you can sue. There's nothing stopping you from filing a lawsuit against, you know, a ham sandwich.
Well, when I brought up jurisdiction, he pointed to the fact of geographical. I was here in the city.
Okay. And you and because you hadn't really been through much, you didn't know how to counter that. It's like, okay, great. So your position is that because I'm in the city, you have jurisdiction. That's called a non sequitur. Do you have how do you know it's true that you have jurisdiction over me merely because of my physical location?
Yeah, and this conversation, unfortunately, was happening after.
I know. I know. But the thing about it is, you know, wasted ammo. It's like, yeah, you didn't, you know what I mean? You can do the setup as best. If you don't bring it together at the end, it really doesn't matter. Because all these questions lead to a conclusion. If you ask halfway and let it go, it's, you don't get there. You know, it's they're designed to get you all the way to a point. If you go halfway and you're back down because of threats and intimidation, it doesn't do enough. You know, playing half a game of chess just doesn't do it.
Okay, so that's a good point. And I didn't have a chance to actually look into all the forms of jurisdiction. How would I have countered that?
Okay, so there aren't forms of jurisdiction. There are things that mean they have jurisdiction. So, okay, so let me use a common analogy I use for this, okay? Imagine that, hold on, let me make sure my battery, okay. Imagine that there's a whiteboard on the wall, okay? And on this whiteboard gets written down anything that would cause them to not have jurisdiction, okay? So all it takes is for one reason for them to not have jurisdiction, and they don't have jurisdiction. Do you follow me so far?
I do.
All right. So anything that rightly goes up on this board of reasons they don't have jurisdiction, any one single thing means they don't have it. Because any reason to not, to say they have jurisdiction means they have the right to impose on you, which means there's nothing.
You cut out.
Top left is.
We lost you for about 10 seconds.
Sorry. Okay, on this board are four quadrants. We're going to divide it up into four sections where we're going to write the things. Okay. So in the top left, we're going to write things that relate also to, what are we going to do on the top left? We'll do subject matter. Top right, we'll do personam, things that relate to your person. Bottom left, we'll do things that relate to location. And bottom right, we'll do things that relate to property in rem, okay? So any reason that they don't have jurisdiction, we're going to try to go put up there, okay? And everything, let's say every objection or every reason they wouldn't have jurisdiction has a natural place on this board, right? There's a spot for it if it's there, okay? And when we say we're going to see if there's any problems with jurisdiction, we'll look at it section by section, okay? Are you following me so far? Because I'm kind of constructing a weird...
I'm writing it down. I've got it in front of me.
Okay. So if, for example, the thing that is accused of happening isn't even mentioned to have occurred within the geographical area of the court that's concerned, that objection would be in the bottom left corner with the territory corner. Do you see what I'm saying?
I do. Okay, so they got
and if there was a problem with accusing the wrong person, it would go in the top right hand corner. Okay, so that would be personam.
Yeah, they got me.
Well, hold on. No, they don't. I bet you that there's objections that go in every quadrant of this. There's probably a billion of them. But anyways, so if it was a subject matter jurisdiction problem, it'd go in the top left corner. So, for example, if they're accusing you of something that isn't even a crime to begin with, right? Or if they're accusing you of something that isn't a crime that that court handles, then it is a subject matter problem. Do you follow me so far?
I do. And we're not talking about crime like damage crime. We're just talking about crimes as
whatever you're accused of. Anything you're accused of has this board, whether it's an infraction, a crime, a speeding, whatever. Any problem with any that goes on any part of this board, anything that would mean that it is wrong for them to take jurisdiction or assert jurisdiction, means that they don't have jurisdiction. Anything anywhere on this whole board. Do you follow me?
Follow.
Okay, so for them to say the bottom left-hand corner is free of any problems doesn't answer the question as to whether they have jurisdiction or not. Do you understand that?
What would constitute a problem?
Okay, so let's say, what was the bottom left-hand corner again? We made location. That subject matter. Location, yes. Yes. So let's say they say, the thing we're accusing you of definitely occurred, it definitely is accused to have occurred in our jurisdictional area. So that bottom left-hand corner is completely free of objections. Do you agree? Just that corner, not the whole board.
Yeah, I suppose I would agree.
Okay. So does that mean they have jurisdiction?
So my inclination is to say no, but I'm
correct.
Sure.
Correct. Jurisdiction means that they are free and clear of any problems with jurisdiction. Any one problem with jurisdiction means they don't have it. Any problem anywhere with jurisdiction is detrimental to the claim of jurisdiction. And several of these spaces are procedural spaces. So, for example, up in the personal corner, there's one that they've defined as you've been given notice via some form or ticket or whatever, right?
Right.
Now, just because that they don't, maybe they satisfied that one space, right? But that doesn't mean that that whole quadrant is free of problems. That just means that one space is free of problems. That they, yes, they gave you a ticket, or yes, that they handed you a notice, or whatever. Yes, they served you with some complaint. But that doesn't mean that that's free and clear. The personam quadrant is free and clear. Because one of the spaces up there is that you've been informed of the cause and nature of the proceedings, by the way.
That's in personam.
The fact that you have been informed of the cause and nature of the proceedings, it's a due process requirement. And the fact that you haven't been informed is a problem up there. Now, there's a way to solve that, because that only applies if you don't have a lawyer. If you have a lawyer, that's satisfied by the fact that your lawyer's been informed to his satisfaction. If you rightly have a lawyer.
At this point, I'm not even sure how to contact my lawyer. I'm going to have to just look up.
I don't think you have a lawyer representing you to begin with. I mean, if you believe you do, great. But it sounds to me like you don't have a lawyer who's representing your interests at all. He seems to be representing her own or the court's interests, not yours.
No, that was pretty obvious.
No, okay. No, it's right there in the record. You're both wrong. See, it says it right there on the computer. He has a lawyer. See?
He has a lawyer right there. Representing his interests, who's very loyal and will represent him. Make very, very sure he has no appealable errors. That all the errors that are made are not appealable. Now you're talking. That all the errors that they make can't be appealed. He will sabotage your appeal on all errors. Which, oddly enough, is very much what they often do.
They just get up and walk away, don't they?
No. Their job is to make sure you have no appealable errors. Like, any errors that are made, they will actually work to make sure you're sabotaged. So, for example, one of the things they generally do is to waive your right to a speedy trial, just to make sure that you don't have any right to appeal based upon the speedy trial problems. So one of the first things they'll do is waive speedy trial. That's not good for you. That's just good for the prosecutor. You know?
Can this guy do it without even talking to me?
Well, absolutely. He represents you. He doesn't need to consult you.
Doesn't he have agency when you walk in there?
Agency?
What do you mean? Agency? What are you describing when you say the word agency?
Choice? Hold.
What?
Yeah.
I think more like standing.
No, you don't have standing. You have standing to plead. That's the end of what they need from you. And then you have standing to accept punishment.
You have standing to obey.
Yeah.
I've never been good with that kind of standing.
But again, it's about having objections to being represented. Do you believe that lawyer is representing your interests to your satisfaction?
Absolutely not.
Well, have you, again, voicing that would be probably, you know, something that would be interesting to think about.
Well, and I do plan on filing a motion voicing that.
Okay. And by the way, I got to get on to you something I heard while I was in the store. Plead for you. Eliminate those words from your vocabulary. The judge pled for you. That is, every time you say that, you're saying he did you a big favor. Thank him very much. It's like a kid helping an old lady across the street that she wasn't going to cross.
What will we replace it with?
Huh?
With what do we replace it?
What's the truth? To your detriment, maybe? He purported to be pleading, but it was to your detriment? Why do you think he pled? Why do you think he said that? To get rid of some ability you had. Probably to get rid of some sense of obligation of informing you of something. Now, do you still have the same ability to get at the cause and nature of the proceedings that you did before he quote-unquote pled for you?
No.
Yeah, he really fucked you over in your ability to get at the cause and nature of the proceedings. So bringing that up, though, will generally get them back on page it's about communicating the fact that you want to know the cause and nature of the proceedings. Everything they're doing is to get it to look like you don't care to know some details that you want to know.
And then telling me that it's not his job to answer those questions.
It is absolutely not the judge's job to answer your questions. I agree with him wholeheartedly. The judge's job is not to answer your questions. Get that instantly in your head. If you look to him to answer your questions, you will be sorely disappointed, and rightly so.
Yeah, he made that clear.
Whose job is it to prosecute you?
Prosecutor.
Yes, part of that job is to inform you the cause and nature of the proceedings and to provide you due process. And anytime the judge steps in to help him to answer some questions, good on him. But he will instantly retreat when he doesn't feel like it.
And no interjections here at all. Considering no one else has, I believe, people believe you'd be in the right. I think I do too. In congruence with what you're saying, a quick recap. So when people say the judge pled for you, say what again?
It's to your detriment.
When you pled to your detriment.
He didn't plead. He didn't plead. What he did was for the prosecutor. He entered a plea for the prosecutor to assist the prosecutor, and it's to your detriment. I'm just getting that concept in your head. Would you say it to him? Probably not. You'd ask a better question. There are better things to say to waste your time, you know, to use your time talking to him. You're better off just skipping the whole clarification and going straight to what you really want to clarify. I'm wanting information. Can I get it? Has the prosecutor provided any evidence of jurisdiction? Yes or no? You know, that kind of stuff.
Did that.
No, you didn't.
Okay.
You didn't finish doing it. You started doing it. You didn't finish doing it. Because it's an ongoing process that will last the entirety of your interactions with them. It's the name of the game.
I guess I wouldn't have... At the point that the judge points to my location as jurisdiction, what...
Wait, okay, so remember what I just got through saying about the thing. He's saying, okay, where your location, this is accused to have happened, so you got to watch it. When they get really squirrely on you, they'll say, where it happened is in the city of whatever the hell, right? It's like, wait a minute, it's why are you presuming it happened? You see?
I gotcha.
So they'll do that all the time. They will say, the thing that you're accused of happened in New York or whatever it is. It's like, wait a minute, you just got done presuming that it happened at all. Why are you presuming that it happened? And why are you presuming that there was... Yeah. It's like, again, they do in fact presume it happened, and they do in fact presume that that it was, you know, that some applicable law was there.
When I brought this up the time before, they used the officer's affidavit to overrule my insistence that it didn't happen.
Okay, well, it's wrong of you to insist that it didn't happen. But you, and again, you want to attack the applicability. You see, the whole thing, they're accusing you of a violation having happened. The violation occurred. Hold on. Something occurred is irrelevant until you go to the violation. See, they're saying a violation occurred. I was like, wait a minute. In order for a violation to have occurred, there needs to be an applicable law. Why are you presuming there's an applicable law? Has the prosecutor presented any evidence that there was a law that is applicable to me?
And why is it wrong to insist that it didn't, Gary? Why is that wrong?
Because as soon as you make an assertion, it's time for court.
And what do you mean by that specifically?
Because you make an assertion, it's time to evaluate the truth of the conflicting assertions. And that is a job for court. That's what trial's all about.
You assume a burden, and lawyers are trained to argue.
Yep.
Your argument realm.
Perfect. You've presented your counter argument, your mitigating fact. That's a pleading. And basically you're saying, I'm innocent because of this counter fact. Great. Let's evaluate these facts. Time for testimony. Time for trial.
If you argue with bar members, you will most likely lose. It's by clarifying their claims where the win lies.
Yes. And asserting a mitigating fact is the same thing as pleading not guilty due to a fact.
And that's so contrary to what most people are used to. You said this. No, that's wrong. I say this. Oh, yeah? Well, I say this. Oh, yeah? Well, I claim this. The skill and the awareness is in the clarification. You already know what's up. By making them keep that burden of proof and define all of their claims and inform you, you make it that way. This is not an argument between family members. We clarify their claims. And the public behind you, man, they're on board with that. If you argue, they're like, oh, okay, well, he argued his case and he lost. It doesn't, you know, you can't win them all. But when you clarify their, well, nonsense, for the lack of a better word, they don't... I don't know what I want to finish that with. It's just...
Yeah, as soon as you try to convince the judge, it will be taken as just that. You're wanting to convince the judge.
At that point, I literally should have said, when he asked me, or when he told me, I'm sorry, when he asserted that he didn't know what I meant by a fair and meaningful hearing. At that point, I should have said, whatever you mean.
No, ask questions. Come up with the best. Okay, so whatever you mean is not a question, right?
Well, what do you mean? What?
So your whole goal in this is to get at what they are, in fact, the full text of what they're trying to say you're accused of. Right? So you're trying to get at the full details of the cause and the nature of the proceedings. The cause, the thing that led you to be in these proceedings, and the nature, the rules, and all that kind of crap that's going to be going forth. So you're asking them about a fair and meaningful hearing. That's about the nature of the proceedings. And if he says, what do you mean by, you know, fair and meaningful, you know, it's like, well, the question that springs to my mind is, which of those two concepts are giving you trouble, Judge? Fair or meaningful?
Yeah, for real.
I'd hate to waste time on the wrong one.
Right. I play that card, and, well, there's two things that come to mind. One is, I'm lost here. Are you stating on the record that you don't know what a fair and meaningful hearing is, and so you're asking?
Yeah. Yeah.
See, at that point, I probably would have went to jail.
Well, you're backing him. Be tactful. I mean, you have to choose the level of risk, and it's your neck on the line, and you're the only one who can judge, you know, whether to back him down or go ahead and let him back you down.
For sure, for sure. Like, here's another tactic to deal with that. If I give you my definition of fair and meaningful hearing, this is a Garyism, thank you. Is it going to have any power here? Will you believe it? Will this court abide by my definition? Because if not, what's the point? I know a judge knows what fair and meaningful hearing means. I know what fair means. I know what meaningful means. What do you mean by it? What part of that do you have a problem with? Let's clarify. Maybe not that exactly, but do you get my point?
Yeah. And honestly, it was kind of difficult because every time I would ask him a clarifying question, I had this lady lawyer in my ear going, oh, well, that's for this and that's for that. And
Yeah. Think of the your quote unquote lawyer as just being another prosecutor.
I did. I was doing my best to ignore.
Well, ignoring just another prosecutor, you can ask, is like, is this the person who's in charge of informing me of the cause and nature of these proceedings?
There's a nice big fat juicy point in here too, because they do this for a lot of terms, namely jurisdiction. But if a judge ever says, what do you mean by blank, and fill in the blank with any legal term or any term, if the court's going to abide by your definition, then okay, I'll give it. But if it has no power anyway, what's the point? So I mean what the court means. Do I have a right to a fair and meaningful hearing, yes or no?
Yeah. And one of my early ways of phrasing this was, are you asking me to make a legal determination?
There you go. There you go.
It's like, because if you really want me to, I will.
They'll always backpedal from that. Oh, no. Oh, no.
Yeah, we don't want any of the other determinations from you. Right, that's for sure.
You stand and this judge flipped right back out of that one.
What's that?
No. Go ahead.
The judge slipped back on out of that one because he didn't ask me what I meant. He just said he didn't know what it meant, and that's why I need to talk to my lawyer.
Oh, even better. The judge claimed that he didn't know what a fair and meaningful hearing was.
I would use that in a motion to void the plea, that's for sure.
100%.
It's like he didn't even know what a fair and meaningful hearing was, but he proceeded to plead what he presumed be on your behalf.
So you're
I've got it posted up here. It's toward the beginning, if you guys have a minute. Maybe I'm missing.
No, it's always the same. It's always the same stuff, man. We hear this a million times. It's gonna be the similar deal with every time you go through this. Man, they only have one song. They just play it at different tempos, is all.
So why is that so much better? That he just said he didn't know what that meant, and that's why I needed to ask my lawyer.
It's a confession.
Well, because he knew that, well, he didn't know. He bet that you wouldn't be able to adequately respond to shoot it down, to counter it. That's why he put it out. If he estimated you as totally capable of embarrassing him with his own words,
yeah,
that would have never been said.
I mean, if you were really feeling cheeky, you could have said, well, if you're the one who doesn't know what fair and meaningful is, maybe you should be asking my lawyer. Or this gal, I should say, not my lawyer.
Ooh, damn. That's hardball right there.
That's hard. Yeah, that's... Yeah, yeah. That's definitely intending to turn the heat up and back him off of such stupid statements. But no, safety first.
It didn't have to get...
I mean, you could always be, you know, say, it's like, well, sir, if you're just being coy about not knowing what fair and meaningful is, then I'd appreciate that if you'd take this a little bit more seriously. Or, you know, or I'd appreciate it if you were just a little bit more, you know, open and honest if you're going to, you know, if you're going to be the one informing me about the cause and nature of these proceedings. Forthright. That's what I'm looking for. Forthright.
I think psychologically in our head, if we don't consider this judge, this all-powerful being, and just in our minds reduce him to an equal, the answers come a lot easier. You know, when a judge says, well, I don't know what a fair and meaningful hearing is. If I was threatening you on the street over a fair and meaningful hearing, and then I said I didn't know what a fair and meaningful hearing was, you would have words for me that were stronger, much stronger than the words that you gave there in court. They would come easier to your mind. I mean, They will say the most ridiculous stuff. They've been doing this for years. They're trained on manipulation, not on law. At this level, it's all about manipulation. They're not going to be held accountable.
Just to give you one of my favorite... Oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
To give you one of my favorite examples of this, I once upon a time had a black female judge tell me she didn't know what the word prejudiced means.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
Okay, they will throw things out just to fuck with the conversation.
That is proof positive. But a black female judge would say, I don't know what prejudice means. That's just hilarious to me.
Right. And it just goes to show you, they're simply manipulating the conversation, and that's it. There's no intent to be honest going on.
This is
and he knew, yeah. And your guy knew damn good and well what fair and meaningful means.
So yeah, break it in half even. Okay, so do you not know what fair means, or do you not know what meaningful means? Everyone knows what fair means. What do you think meaningful means in a courtroom environment, or traditionally, maybe?
Yeah, and another question comes to mind. You know, if he's playing that game with you, again, at different points in the whole back and fight back and forth, is, you know, is it your intention to also have the prosecutor clarify completely mundane terms?
So I'll just put it out there too. Meaningful means they don't get to waste your time, that progress must be made, that they can't just go, delay arraignment attempt number 11. Delay arraignment attempt number 12. Delay arraignment 13. For reasons X, Y, and Z, right? If you have the right to be informed, then there should be no delay in anything about meaningful. So it's just clarifying what they're saying. And when you can do that to their obvious attempts at manipulation, you make your life there a whole lot easier, because they will stop trying to pull these nonsense kindergarten level manipulations to gain your obedience, right?
Yeah. And there's a bunch of these games. I mean, they go on and on. If you ask, do I have the right to be informed? You know, they'll say, you have been informed. You know, and there's a natural counter of, is it a matter of right that I'm informed, or is it just something you believe has happened coincidentally? I'm asking about, do I have a right to be informed? You know, he's trying to make the question go away by giving you a little factoid of his opinion rather than answering the question.
Upon what evidence do you rely on to conclude that I've been informed?
Yeah. I have a question on the table that I've not gotten an answer to. How am I informed if I don't know the answer to a simple yes or no question about the cause and nature of the proceedings? Hell, I don't know if I have the right to be informed of the cause and nature of the proceedings.
Does this court accept uninformed pleas?
I mean, all those questions that you read, you know, that we've put in different stuffs are there for a reason. It's there to help kind of paint them into a corner on some normal tactics that we see them use over and over and over again. So they might seem a little strange until you get to the point in the role play where you're like, oh, this is, you know, that thing I asked about earlier totally relates to this guy, what he's trying to use right now. It's like, do I still have the right to be informed of the cause of these proceedings, or do I, you know, or did I lose them a second ago for some reason? You know, did I lose them because you said you're pleading for me, or did I, you know, and if so, you know, how do I avoid losing them? You know, it seems like you just got rid of something I really value.
Earlier, you confessed that I had a right to a fair and meaningful hearing. At what moment in time did I lose that right?
You following us, buddy? You with us? Did we lose him?
I don't know. Who is him? I'm on my cell phone.
Let's see. Hold on. Hold on. I'm trying to pull it up again.
You're talking to Mitzel.
Mitzel, yeah.
Oh, okay, cool.
I'm just trying to pull up the screen and see if he's still in the room.
You might have just blew his mind.
He's reeling. But I thought he said he watched a bunch of videos. That's the thing. It's like, man, I say this a billion times everywhere.
That's what they all say. I've been watching videos for years. Like, oh, yeah, what are the three transitions?
Yeah. It's like that's the three transitions is mentioned at least in one in every three videos.
Yeah. I like to hear you sharpen your claws on the scratching post game. In a while.
There he is.
Good time, sir.
Sorry, the number press must have went out. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you again now.
The three transitions are the gun in the room.
That's number two.
Let's see.
What's number one?
The number one. Oh, God damn it.
They're chronological, by the way.
Yeah, they are.
So it's the first one you utilize, but then the second one you utilize maybe if the opportunities arise, and then the third one is the one where you're trying to get that judge around to your side of the table a little bit. So the first one is to get him to kind of get moving a little bit instead of just sitting there, you know, right up the prosecutor's butt, and then the second one is to thwart him trying to get you to stop, and then the third one is to get him on fully on your side of the table.
So, the right to be informed, the gun in the room.
Not quite. What's your first position? It's a thing to talk about to get him to satisfy whatever he threw at you, and kind of bury it again, and then come back to your point. It's a transition from what he was trying to talk about back to what you were trying to talk about.
So, the intent to plead guilty, I use that
one. There you go.
The gun in the room.
Hold on. So let's slow it down. So at the beginning, you're just saying, hey, listen, I'm just trying to plead guilty. The only reason we're having conversations, the only reason I want to drag this out here for the moment is not to waste time, but rather to plead guilty and stop wasting time. I just want to know a couple quick pieces so we can be done. so I can plead guilty. Informed and quote-unquote voluntary.
I guess I didn't get around to the prosecutor's failure because he was stating the prosecutor hadn't failed.
Okay, so if he's telling you... So transition two is good when he's trying to tell you things like, I'm just going to make you go ahead and come back tomorrow, or, you know, I'm just going to go ahead and blah, blah, blah. You know, I have jurisdiction because you showed up. You know, it's good for those kind of situations. I have jurisdiction because you are here.
So about
I have jurisdiction because you answered the paperwork.
No, I'm only here because you guys are threatening me with violence if I don't come here.
It's, listen, what would happen if I didn't? You know, oh, we have jurisdiction because you got a driver's license. It's all gun in the room topics, right?
Yeah.
And that's why I'm saying they're just kind of standard go-to transitions. And as you get better, you customize them and you wander away from them and come up with more tailored things.
Gotcha.
And then the third one. What was the third one? Prosecutor's failure?
Prosecutor's failure.
So he said to you the prosecutor didn't fail because you hadn't yet made the point. You just said the prosecutor failed, probably.
No, we got to... I asked if one of the elements was jurisdiction, and he pointed to the geographical nature of what was going on and said that...
And you didn't understand. And you didn't understand your point well enough to kind of combat that.
Exactly. I didn't...
How would you do so now? Okay, you still don't understand well enough to combat that.
No, you're
what right. Is the number one weakness that the prosecutors do in malum prohibitum cases? Evidence of applicability? 4,000?
Thanks, Alex.
How would you bring that in?
The prosecutor...
Can you say the question again?
Sure, yeah. Can I have the question one more time?
Well, I'm trying to get him to phrase a question. So what question would you ask... What question would you ask to, you know, transition back to what you're trying to talk about? Or what transition plus question would you use?
Well, I don't know. The question I did ask was, so you're relying on the geographical nature?
That's not a question. Hold on. So you're relying on the geographical nature is a sentence, not a question. And just because you go up at the end of the sentence doesn't make it a question. Think about how it would be written by a transcript.
Well, he did cut me off before I got to the question, but that's about where I...
Of course.
You're a very good judge, Gary. But,
yeah. Listen, I'm just trying to teach you how to kind of wield the language a little bit, if you indulge me.
Yeah.
You started that with so you have jurisdiction. Incredulity doesn't have any place in court. It doesn't write well. So it's like, oh, so you have jurisdiction? That's we use that in like on the street as a incredulity and you know indignation. It's taken as a question and a challenge, but it's literally a sentence of agreement. It's like, so you have jurisdiction, period. And written down, it reads exactly like that. So be very careful to actually be asking a question when you intend to be. A question begins like how, what, when, where, why, that kind of stuff is best. And the best questions are yes and no answers. Absolutely, by far. That way you know when it's been answered, you can write it down, and you can refer to it easily.
So in that instance, what kind of question would have brought it back to me just wanting to be informed?
That's what we're up to, man. We're trying to shaping you up into generating questions. So the goal of the question is, what was the thing that was stated by the judge that you're trying to bring around? He has jurisdiction because of your location.
Because it's happened in the city of Yakima.
Okay. So what question builds on that? So it's a prosecution's failure. He's saying the prosecution didn't fail. He's saying, hey, look at the board. There's nothing. Oh, go ahead.
Are you asserting that the prosecutor has met his burden of proof or of evidence?
It's not his job to answer your question. He would just move on to scheduling trial.
Let me see your evidence?
That's a demand, not a question at all.
May I see your evidence?
No. It's not his job to answer your question.
Okay, well, I'm sorry. At this point, you turn around and talk to the prosecutor?
Why? I'm asking. No. Just stick with the exercise. The exercise is for you to generate a question that points to the failure of the prosecutor.
Generate a question based off his assertion of the geographical
location. He just said that he has jurisdiction because you were in that location. You generate a question that points out a failure in his thinking.
I'm not sure I can. I don't know exactly everything that he did.
Now, what he did is called a non sequitur, right? Do you remember that part where I was talking a minute ago?
It's Latin.
Yep. Non sequitur means
non sequitur is a Latin phrase that's talking about just it's not flowing.
Yeah. Okay. So what if I came up to you? Here's an example. Here's a demonstration. So what if I came up to you and I said, "Dude, it is Wednesday and you're wearing shoes. You owe me $20."
Why? Right. I owe you $20 for not wearing
that. You owe me because you're not wearing shoes. So you ask me, how does not wearing shoes and being Wednesday lead to me owing you $20, right?
Yes.
Okay, that is called a challenge. That is a clarification question. Now, again, a better question would be yes and no questions, but you did identify the non-sequitur. Shoes and Wednesday and $20 don't seem to have anything to do with each other. Now, what if I was being honest and I said, man, last month I bet you $100 to your 20 that you'd be wearing shoes today when I saw you. And you forgot, so you owe me $20. Now that would be, oh shit, you know, so you did. But if I refused to answer your question and said, none of your business, I have not filled in the gaps and I've not informed you
of the reason why I owe you 20, or I owe you 20.
Well, I have not informed you of the full reason for the assertion. I'm asserting that because you're wearing shoes and it's Wednesday, you owe me $20. And if you say, why do I owe you $20? I'll say, because it's Wednesday and you're not wearing shoes. And that is the answer.
But not completely.
But it's there's a non sequitur. There's a piece you don't know. So asking about the gap is important. So, back to the lawyer or judge. You are located in the city, thus we have jurisdiction. What's the question?
How does my geographical location give you jurisdiction over me?
Fair enough. It's the right thought.
It's not yet.
How about this? Well, there's a better one, yeah. I didn't say it was a great one. It's the right thought. So how do we construct a yes or no question? Now, here's something else to keep in mind.
Is it your assertion that the geographical nature of the charge...
Let me bring something else into your mind so that you can construct this a little bit better. Shut now up. That you're at the next level. The judge is not there to come up with the accusation. He's not there to make one up and create one. That was the prosecutor's job. The judge might be relaying that information to you, but if he relays it to you, it has to come from something he received from the prosecutor, not on the golf field. And that echo is really messing with me, so I'm sorry if I say wrong.
Is your speaker close to your earpiece, Mitzel?
No, it's not. Actually, I had to switch. For some reason, the press button voice deal went off. That's when you guys lost me. Let me try to fix it.
Yeah. Well, there's just enough delay to where the this noise suppression isn't kicking in.
It's going to give me a stroke.
You still with us? Am I still with us?
I hear you.
Oh, good. I thought my phone had shut off there for a minute. I think you disconnected for a minute. I'm going to try. Oh, there he is.
Now, for some reason, the push to talk went out.
All right. So keep in mind that it's the judge's job to, at most, relay information that's already in his possession. He's not supposed to make anything up. And anytime he tells you something, you should be able to trace it back to information he's received in open communication from the prosecutor. Not in some ex parte meeting, some behind the scenes between them meeting about your case. They're not even supposed to do that. If you catch them doing that, it's a very bad thing for them. So, yeah. So a yes or no question could revolve around simply, has he given you any evidence of that little thing we were just talking about? Do you follow?
What would constitute as evidence? Because obviously he said...
We'll get into that next. Has the prosecutor provided you any evidence that the Constitution and codes apply to me merely because I'm located in the city of blah, blah, blah? It's a yes or no question. We can talk about what it is after he says yes or no.
Okay, so I need to take the same question and just dig it a little bit deeper.
Well, we're clarifying here. We're getting at the root of things. The one thing we know is missing. See, here's the thing. There is no such thing. It is presumed that the codes apply to you based upon nothing at all. Unless you happen to have signed something. Are you aware of ever having signed something swearing your loyalty to a city?
No.
Well, that's a good thing. That's promising. So it's not very likely that you'll be the first person ever to have evidence brought up as to why the codes apply to you, right? Possible, but unlikely.
around here, yeah, I don't know.
So he knows, the judges don't answer this question. The only thing they got is to make the question go away. Their whole job becomes making that question go away. And they're good at it. Don't underestimate them. They're very good at making that question go away. Because that is the heart of, that is a very, very deeply striking question that they cannot answer either way, yes or no. Well, they'll sometimes answer yes, and then you'll have to back them down and show that they were just full of shit.
When they answer then, yes. Sorry, go ahead, Gary.
Yeah, so let's say you ask that question, and the judge answers yes. Okay, what's your follow-up question?
Has the prosecutor admitted any evidence stating...
You already asked that one. What's your follow-up question that gets more specific on what he just confessed? He says, yes, the prosecutor has... Yes, and in the subtext is, the prosecutor has submitted evidence that proves that you were, codes, constitution codes apply to you simply because of your location.
Great. Can I take a look at it?
Yeah, that's a fair question. Is it in the record? Can I have a look in the, where in the record is it? You know, that kind of stuff. That's where your thoughts should go. There's better ways of phrasing everything, but the investigative nature is, great, I just got you to confess something that can't be true. Let's have a look at it. Show your lion through your lion teeth. And all of this is built up around that one question, by the way.
You know, yeah, I pretty much dropped everything else and focused on this.
No, everything else that you might have learned and so forth might be, you know, might have its place after this. But this question at the outset, and you're still at the outset, you're there's just the fact that he wants to shove you into the next step doesn't mean you no longer have the right to be informed of the cause and nature of the proceedings. Do you, at present, have the right to this information? Do I have the right to know whether or not the prosecution has provided evidence about the codes and constitution being applicable to me? Yes or no? It's a yes or no question. And if I don't have that right, why not? I want that right. I've always wanted that right. My primary function has been to have that right and to plead guilty. If I discover that the constitution and codes are applicable, hey, if you discover that the constitution and codes are applicable, you might as well hang up your hat and plead guilty, man. It'd be stupid for you to go to trial if that's true.
Well, they kind of are applicable. I mean, oh. Applicability is on their hip, right?
What's that?
The applicability is on their hip.
Right. They have a nice clip loaded into their applicability. But if all we're talking about is that they have the force it takes to apply it, that's a different question. Then why bother arguing either? It's like there is zero doubt that they have more arms than you do.
How would they have jurisdiction? At the moment you guys said that.
Okay, so it's possible that they could. So how would that board be completely free and clear of anything, of any problem? I can come up with a scenario. Let's say someone joined the military, signed up willingly, wholeheartedly, read the code of conduct, violated one of those rules, was given his accusation, you know, in full, was informed of all of his rights in his courts martial or whatever it be, and they would have jurisdiction then.
The only way they can actually have that scenario is because he signed into it knowingly and willingly.
Well, you asked me for a scenario where they would have jurisdiction. I gave you one. I mean, there might be others. Okay, so let's say someone actually does violently harm another human being. That other human being goes to the prosecutor in court to get justice. That court goes to the accused and fully informs him of his accusation, of the accusation against him, of the violent act committed, of all the evidence that was committed, basically completely outlining proof as to how he was guilty, right? And then offered him the opportunity to defend himself or to agree with that guilty by pleading guilty. You know, if some other things are satisfied, they could have jurisdiction in theory.
Both of these scenarios contend that there's a victim, damage, or you join the military. I mean, is there any way to get this?
Is there any way for an innocent person who is not willing to become subject to a court? Is that what you're asking me?
Yeah, somebody who hasn't.
Yes. So, okay, so there are four quadrants here, okay? There's willing, no, we're not talking about the jurisdiction one. We're talking again now about four different quadrants. there's two columns. There's willing and unwilling, and then there's the rows are guilty and innocent, okay? And we're talking about what actually is, not what people know. We're talking about actually guilty or actually innocent. We're talking about actually willing or actually unwilling. Okay? Fair enough? Those are the four different quadrants that a person accused of something can be in. Do you agree?
Yeah. I don't have any reason why not to.
Perfect. So, someone who is guilty can't really object to jurisdiction of his victim. Okay? Ethically, the only way he would be able to object to jurisdiction be taken over him if he already made amends. then he would no longer be guilty. He would be, you know, have made amends. The innocent person, the one who is willing, you know, he doesn't object. The personam jurisdiction side is pretty free and clear. Okay. All else being, you know, kind of satisfied, they can actually have jurisdiction over him as well. But the innocent and unwilling person, I can't see of a way for them to gain jurisdiction over him without violence and without fraud. Do you follow me?
I do, yes.
Cool. So does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Cool. So jurisdiction is just a justified exertion of power. And there's no real way to separate out the ethics of it, because if it's not justified, what does it mean? It just means power. There already is a word for power.
Right, there is no word.
There's plenty of synonyms, and it's not a synonym for power. And if anybody tries to tell you, it's like, well, we have jurisdiction because we have power. It's like, okay, so to you, jurisdiction is merely a synonym for might. It's like, and so you're interpreting everything to mean that my rights to challenge jurisdiction is just my ability to challenge your power. Challenge the amount of power you have. And that would be cause for kind of an interlocutory. Of course, you could back him down with some questions about that. You just back him down in the sense that you show him the note to be full of shit. And that his boss would see, hey, you won this one based upon something that's so clearly full of shit that every lawyer ever is going to go, what the fuck was with this idiot? Not that political pressure is always successful, but it's all we got.
When you guys suggest political pressure, is that just within the courtroom?
Oh, I'm sorry. We're just kind of highlighting the fact that this is merely... There is no overarching, like, rule of physics that makes this go the right way. And there is no, like, natural order of things that's going to make this judge do right if you say the right things and do the right things. This is all an attempt to get him to do the right thing by pointing out that his life will become less comfortable by doing the wrong thing. And in that manner is what we're talking about, it being a political fight more than a fight of definitions. You know, you can't, oh, I pull out the right case citation and he'll just bow to it. It's like, no, he doesn't give a fuck about any of that. All he gives a fuck about is accomplishing his goals of collecting money and making it look good. Make sense?
It does. So in any situation, no motion or I file, I'm going to have to be able to articulate this without them being able to.
It's still not. I'm not sure if you might be right. Let's explore that. You say articulate it. If you say all the right words of the motion, that may not be enough, because part of the game here is about indicating to him that he is going to look bad to his bosses and his peers and whatever, right? And the public. And that the bar is going to take a hit for this and look a little bit less noble. And that's something that's kind of important to a lot of them, that whole nobility of the bar association and judges hoity-toity, bullshitty, whatever, you know? And they kind of like to think of themselves as, they're certainly not above just fucking people over, but they want to make it look good. And when they fail to make it look good, their bosses notice. So they're supposed to screw you over without you really making a big fuss. Or at least if you make a fuss, it's not supposed to be very coherent. They're supposed to be able to kick the feet out from under you to where you look like a blathering idiot. And they do real good at that, usually. I mean, a lot of the people who advocate common law and so forth, one of the worst things they do for themselves is to, they proceed to tell the judge what the law is. You know, do you have the right to be informed of the, you know, cause and nature of the proceedings? Well, see, a lot of common law people say, think that they have the right to tell the judge the nature of the proceedings. I'm going to tell you what the law is all about. Man, that's a rough way to go.
No, I'm just trying to clarify what it means, right?
It's all about, you see, we take that other tact, that Socratic tact of getting them to tell us, leveraging the fact that supposedly they have an obligation to inform us. They, meaning the prosecutor. The judge is just helping his buddy prosecutor out when he takes that up. And he's going on about informing you. He could just as easily say, Mr. Prosecutor, tell him about the cause and nature of these proceedings so we can get on with this. Nothing wrong with that. Because the prosecutor's, if he doesn't, it's failure to prosecute. And by the way, when he doesn't, when you bring up the fact that you want to know why, you know, what causes this, you know, Constitution and codes to be applicable, how he knows it to be true, he's asserting it. It's kind of his obligation to either provide it or he's failing to prosecute. He should be sent home. They don't, of course. They want the question to go away instead. And the amount of work they do is insane sometimes to make that question go away. You'll listen to things. It'll just gut-wrenching sometimes how much work these judges do to get people to withdraw that question. Has the prosecutor provided any evidence that the Constitution and codes apply to me? And we've seen people thrown in jail for weeks and months on end, you know, over that question. More than once, come to think of it. Now, granted, not everybody gets that kind of treatment. This is something that had been going on for a very long time. Many, many arraignment attempts, and the judge just was finally just fed up because he was being made to look like a fool for too long of a time. And he was just willing to go ahead and throw caution to the wind and take the lumps of doing wrong.
Locking him up?
And locked him up. Like 60 days, I think it was, for very calmly asking that question. But he was already at that point. I mean, it's super rare. That's a very, very isolated incident in that, you know, that judge had already been in a feud with him for years leading up to this. But in this instance, it was the first thing that happened, you know. And then we know someone, you know, he said, you will stop asking these questions. You will either plead guilty or not guilty or take a lawyer, or you will go to jail. Those are the only things that have a chance of happening. I will throw you in jail if you don't choose from the list of things I let you choose from. And you have no rights beyond that. And, you know, actually overtly said, fuck everything else. Now, he asked a question, and then the judge came back at the light. You know, after he came back, the judge was something, if I remember right, was something like, well, I didn't really mean that, but you need to choose. You know, basically kind of giving him a way to weasel out of it, you know?
I gotcha. I wish I would have learned this stuff when I was younger.
Well, here we are, right? We learn about things when we have to.
Yeah, that's very true.
So you're scheduled for something, aren't you? You're probably scheduled for something like in a week or some shit like that, aren't you?
Me? No, I'm not scheduled until July, middle of July.
Still not a lot of time, but yeah. Have you watched a lot of videos?
I have. I've got a lot of them downloaded on the computer.
Okay, yeah. Cool. Make your way through them, man. You'll come up with questions, no doubt. And then you'll get kind of a feel for what things, where role plays head and all that kind of stuff. And then you'll need to do some. If you need to find someone, maybe someone at your own level who's also doing a similar deal and just fight, you know, spar with them. So you can kind of say to him things that you're worried about judges saying and see how he or she tackles them and that kind of shit.
Yeah, at this point, I think that's the only way that I'm going to actually get more fluent in this.
Well, I mean, part of this is, I mean, you can read about it and hear about it all you want until you're actually trying to put yourself under that gun where you got to think on your feet. Man, it's just like watching someone do math. It just doesn't help. You know, it'll help you kind of get down certain concepts, but until you're actually up there at the board trying to do it for yourself, man, it doesn't count. And I even think that in order to get a true role play scenario, you should have to, every time you do well, you should have to dunk your feet in ice in an ice bucket.
Just so you get the anguish that they're going to cause you for doing well.
Yeah. Yeah, it's reversed encouragement, you know. When you're doing well is when you're under the most stress. So it's the incentive is backwards. And that's what usually is the downfall of most people is, you know, it's like, I would have been doing well. I thought about the right thing to do, and I just did the wrong thing instead. Well, yeah, because you were afraid. And, you know, being afraid... Some people don't even realize how afraid they were until way after the, you know, listening to the hearing, you know, weeks later, they're like, oh shit, man, why did I say that? I had to go safe. I didn't, you know, I had him on the ropes and I let him get up, you know?
Yeah, I had that exact thing happen today.
All right. Today? Friday.
No, today, listening back to the recording today.
Oh, I see. Yeah. It's really hard to make a solid, really incriminating point against a judge. It's a dangerous thing. You know it. You know, you don't want to fuck with him. You know, everything in you says don't piss him off. And that's really hard to get past. Really hard to get past. And it's always easy to talk good. I talk a big talk, man. Who knows? If I was sitting across from a fucking psychopath, you got to judge it for yourself, man. You know, there's no way to prejudge it and say, I'm just going to be fucking balls to the wall. I don't give a shit. Man, some of these psychopaths are just not to be, just, they don't give a fuck. But it's all about figuring out where that line is and figuring out where your balls are at. See, Joe's got an attitude, man. He's like, fuck it. I'm going balls to the wall every time. But sometimes, man, that's hard to do.
Yeah, well, it served me well.
Right. Because it's like that. It's like playing cards, man. You know, even if he's got a shit hand, he's going to look like he's fucking got you dead to rights.
I'm actually playing poker right now as I listen to this. That makes all kinds of sense. For real.
Yeah, that judge, even if he's like, fuck, I'm fucked, I need to kind of let this guy go, he's going to act all the way until he tells you that, he's going to act like you're fucked. And we've seen that, too. We've seen them act like, man, you got no chance. Why are you even bringing this shit up? Granted. You know? Demure's granted. Or they completely, you know, fuck him over as like, you know, you're going to trial in 3 weeks and blah, 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 blah. And then a week later, they send out something saying they withdraw the charges or dismissed them or whatever on their own motion, reconsidered the demurrer. Keep that in mind, man. You know, their gut reaction is to instantly deny the demurrer. That's the motion to dismiss for failure to state a case. That's what I'm talking about there.
Yeah.
But that's always there. The fact that you brought that point up doesn't go away. And you're still arguing about it, and that the topic doesn't go away just because he denied the motion. The point you made remains unresolved. You see, I deny that motion. Yeah, the motion was just there so that you could talk about the fact that there was a failure to show the evidence of applicability. You know, and just because he's like, I denied it because you misspelled the word. I don't know what the hell he denied it for. It doesn't matter. You know, he might find it in his heart later to say, oh, you know what, after thinking about how he meant it, I kind of agree with him. You know, he might just want to fight because all's well that ends well. They can deny your motion at the beginning of a four-visit ordeal and then grant it at the end, and it's as if he granted it at the first minute. Same thing. Doesn't cost him any extra. And think about it. If he's a poker player, why not take the extra free turns to see if you fuck yourself over? Does that make sense?
It makes perfect sense.
So if you were an evil, nasty judge coming up with a strategy to make yourself the best money, you take all the free turns you can. They think that you taking a trip down to the courthouse is free. You know, that's why I have that whole number, part of why I have that whole number two. It's like, listen, I come down here. It's of great peril. What if I'm late? What if my bus crashes? You know, what if my car, you know, runs out of gas or has some mechanical problem on the way? I can go to jail over not making it here on time. Every time you make me come here. It's a real and valid threat to my well-being. And in your case, even more so. So it's not just a no big deal to reschedule these things. I'm here to resolve this quickly, and I'm even willing to plead guilty today. It's my intention to plead guilty here today. All I want to do is resolve a couple little minor inconvenient questions. You know, a couple softballs, and, you know, get into the hardball. And then he's going to be trying to schedule, you know, put a plea in for you. I mean, he already put in a plea for you. So your job is to point out that you're trying to be informed. Do I have a right to plead guilty here today? Oh, I do? Great. Do I have a right to make an informed plea here today? Oh, I do. Okay, do I have the right to be informed of the cause and nature of these proceedings today? You know, do I have a right to a fair and meaningful hearing today? Since it was already an issue, you know, questionable issue last time, you know, all these ongoing things, just because they quote unquote scheduled a whatever pretrial conference or something, which by the way, they'll probably schedule if you put in the motion to vacate, put in a pretrial conference and then deny it. And then you'll be stuck kind of discussing the issue that you raised anyways. But just like I said with the other thing, they can deny it at the beginning and change their mind at any point. So the gut reaction is always just, we'll put the denial on the record and fix it if we feel like it. You know? No harm, no foul on that, right?
Right. Can I ask you something about the motion?
Which one?
I turned in a demur motion the morning of this hearing. Do I need to do that again?
You turned in a demur the morning of this hearing, and then what happened to that?
Well, since it was the morning of the hearing, it didn't get to the judge. They didn't address it.
You don't think you got a copy of it?
No, I don't think so. It was literally like 10 minutes before.
You didn't bring it up?
No, the only thing I brought up was the guilty plea.
Okay. So you have the right to challenge standing at any time. Any time whatsoever. Even on appeal for the first time. Even, supposedly, during the execution of the sentencing. Or any time that the sentencing has an impact on your life. Any time. So a failure in standing is a failure to for them to proceed on any point whatsoever until that issue is addressed, like if you raise an issue. Now, you can't re-raise an issue that's already been satisfied. You can't, like, ask a question that's already been answered. But you can raise, you can challenge standing, supposedly, at any time. And I don't think they'll fight that idea very much. They might try to say that's an issue for trial, which is true. It's an issue for trial, it's an issue for pretrial, it's an issue for arraignment, it's an issue for every minute of every day. But they'll try to distract you by telling you something that's completely true and misleading, right? They'll say, that's an issue for trial. Great, good to know that. It's also an issue for now, or is it? You know, is it an issue for now as well? Are you telling me that I cannot address standing at this particular hearing? Because that would then be a denial of due process. It's a problem. And cause for, like, an interlocutory. Not that they won't do it. They do all kinds of weird shit. But I'm just telling you. Keep it in mind.
Okay, so these things don't, like, expire or just disregard.
Here's how a challenge to standing gets satisfied. They answer the question and resolve it. Or they get you to drop it. Those are the two ways to resolve it. Which way do you think they usually use?
I'm inclined to say they get you to drop it.
And did they successfully do so far with you? By ignoring it?
By having it not even be broached? Yeah.
Well, it's your job to broach it. You're your own lawyer, right? Well, yeah, not really. You're the closest thing you got to someone who gives a shit.
You're correct.
So if you don't give a shit, no one will. If you don't raise an objection, no one will. If you don't raise a question, no one will. If you don't raise a challenge, no one will.
Understood.
Except the sabotage, you know, the defense attorney, probably whoever that is, will sabotage your appeal. You know, they'll do plenty of that. Make sure there's no appealable errors. So, ask when the hearing is scheduled for on that motion.
July 18th.
So you have a motions hearing for that motion on July 18th?
No, he denied me a motion.
Hold on. Stop. The fuck. Okay, you handed it a motion. Okay. Is the motion denied? Or is it going to be done without a hearing?
It hasn't been addressed.
Okay. So, there are a couple different ways motions can be handled. They're all completely okay, as long, you know, with due process as far as I know it. You put in the motion. Did you get, does the prosecutor have a copy?
I didn't expressly. They're all in the same building. Should I have brought them on?
I'm sorry. Who has the motion?
I filed it with the court clerk.
And you failed to give a copy to the prosecutor?
Yes.
That might be a problem in your area. I don't know if that doesn't count as service. I don't know. Unless they have some kind of a system down there that's enough. Which I doubt. You failed to serve the opposing party. And so that motion, he doesn't have opportunity to respond to it. So they're just leaving it sit there. Because you failed to make everybody aware of it.
Okay, so refile the motion with...
No, that's not what I said. So what did you do in the motion where it says you served the opposite party, that thing on the back of the motion, the certificate of service? What'd you do? Did you just, I don't know, put some ink on your dick and rub it around the page or what?
I signed it and gave it to the clerk.
I'm sorry, you signed it saying you'd served a copy upon the opposing party and gave it to the clerk, so you committed fraud?
Looks like I'm going to have to take a look at the back part of that
thing. Yeah, you might want to do that. Because if you certified that you gave a copy to the opposing counsel and didn't, dude, you might want to fix that.
Gotcha. I know what I'm doing tomorrow.
Jesus. Oh, wow. Yeah, fix that. Yeah. All right. Okay, so once you've properly served the opposing party, oh, man. And straighten that out and maybe submitted an apology to the court for the error. I don't know what else. You'll have to ask someone else about the best way to approach all that. But then it's an issue that you've raised, right? You've raised the issue that there is a demurrer. Now, you have an attorney, don't you? According to that, I'm sorry. Was that a yes?
I haven't went out to find an attorney. I haven't sucked one out. But
No. There wasn't there a gal who quote unquote represented the whole everybody in the courtroom?
There was.
Now, so they would ignore you no matter what you said. Because you have this quote-unquote attorney on record, right?
Yeah. I don't know. Would they? Are they going to ignore the
motion? I don't know. Again, you're asking me. This is wild and weird altogether. You know, so you have this lady who sabotaged your position and may or may not now represent you. The fact that you don't even know is a big telling problem. You know?
She's not the lawyer they appointed to represent me now.
Okay, so there was someone representing you then and a different person, quote unquote, appointed to represent you now.
Yes.
Did you ask for this appointment?
No.
Okay, how did it come to be that they are appointing you someone without you wanting it?
He was appointing lawyers to everybody, pretty much automatically as they went up.
Oh, okay, pretty much automatically is not a very specific and precise way to talk about things. And so we don't really like pretty much whatever because the devil's in the details.
Okay, everybody that went up there, he put in...
He put in...
A not guilty plea.
Okay, you're fucking bringing up too many topics for me to even get my head around. So, he put in a not guilty plea and assigned everybody a lawyer. Is that what you're trying to say?
Yes.
Okay, and the precise way in which he did that is you come up and he says, I'm putting in a not guilty plea on your behalf and assigning you this lawyer here. Here's his card. That's his face right there. That's what he looks like. Say hi to him. And then go talk amongst each other. Is that what happened?
No, the first part was correct. The last part, not so much. I don't have any information on this.
Okay. Lawyer. Did you ask a question before you said, I'm putting in that guilty plea in on your behalf? Did a question leave your lips before that?
As he was saying it?
Eck? Oh, I lost you.
So as he was saying that, did I ask him a question?
Well, I mean, before, during, after, whatever. Was there any question on the table that had not been answered about the cause or nature of the proceedings?
God, probably not.
Okay. Had he read you the charges? Is that what he did? He read you the charges and said, do you understand? Or anything like that?
he read me the chart, or he read the charges as I was walking up, and then asked my name and date of birth.
Tricky, very tricky. Got you to forget to ask about them. Presume that you understood. So you're charged with blah, blah, blah. What's your name? When were you born? And you answered it, of course. And then he said, I'm putting in a plea of not guilty for you and assigning you this lawyer.
Precisely.
Okay. And when did all this thing come up where he was threatening you with contempt and so forth? Was it after that or before? Or?
It was after that. He asked about my ability to pay for a lawyer.
Wait a minute. He already assigned you a lawyer, and then he's asking you about your ability to pay for a lawyer?
Yes. He went over my bills and...
Wait. You submitted your bills?
Verbally.
Okay. So we asked you about what your expenses were in life, and you told him. And you had no questions for this about, you know, any of this.
No.
Until you got to something you didn't like. I forget what it was.
It was my question if I'm here for a fair and meaningful hearing.
So after you gave him all your billing details, you asked him, you know, do I have the right to a fair and meaningful hearing? Is that right?
Yes.
And sorry, then he said... No.
So I suppose strike that I suppose part. Uh-huh. He asked me about my bills, decided I was indigent, and proceeded to assign me a lawyer, at which time I told him I'm not sure I'll be proceeding with a lawyer.
Okay, good. Great. And then you asked him, do you have the right for a fair and meaningful hearing? And he had a fit?
That's when he said, I don't know what that means.
But he didn't say anything about the, I don't know if I'll be proceeding with a lawyer. He didn't have any correction or anything like that.
No. The gal that was sitting next to me that was supposed to be, or that they claim was my lawyer, spoke up at that point and said, he's already ordered you a lawyer.
He ordered you a lawyer. Is that literally what she said?
Assigned? I'd have to go back and listen, but yeah. I mean, something to that effect. He's already assigned you a lawyer, or he's already ordered you a lawyer.
That's really not relevant. I don't care about her opinion on it at all. But that does indicate that she's not a lawyer, your representation at that point. Or at least that there's a confusing point on the table. You don't have any reason to believe that you're represented at that point in time. You're speaking for yourself, being asked questions for yourself, you know? Okay. Well, interesting. So let me tell you a little story that happened in one of my ordeals. It was a civil ordeal without the state involved. Other than the judge really wanted me involved because some big companies wanted me involved. So one of the people involved, I was fighting standing, and I was fighting being deposed, right? A deposition, they wanted to get me in on a deposition, and I was fighting tooth and nail, and they didn't get shit. But one of the tactics that one of the guys used was he sent somebody to a lawyer acting like me, saying he was me, right? And hired a lawyer in my name. Okay?
Wow.
Now, they didn't want to send me any paperwork because it goes to this lawyer, except that something did come to me from someone at some point. And I went on to, you know, to point out that I had no idea who this person was or why he's under the impression that he has me as a client, you know, and some questions and blah, blah, blah. And basically all the reference to that lawyer the next week was gone. As if it never was in any record. It's not that they undid it and said, oh, this was an error.
it was just gone, as in never there. Right?
Right. Well, he broke the law, didn't he?
The law is just the opinion of the highest ranking judge involved in a situation, or speculation about what that would be. Do you believe that any judge would go against his own to say that was against the law?
No, I see your point.
Okay, cool. So, it's your job to clarify all this. They made it a big old clusterfuck nonsense mess. So, you know, you have some motions to put in, perhaps, to clarify this. You know, one motion to clarify that you desire no representation, or do you, are you, well, no, that's not even true. You don't know if you want representation. Why would you give up the right to go back to get representation of your own choosing? So why bother? Screw that up. You might want to shop for an attorney after you've been informed of the cause and nature of the proceedings. Doesn't that make sense? Wouldn't it be sensible for you to know the cause and nature of the proceedings and to find a lawyer who understood that situation to your liking? Do you follow me?
Absolutely.
Do you have the right to know the cause and nature of the proceedings before choosing a lawyer, or do you have to choose one blindly before you've been informed of the cause and nature of the proceedings? That's a question to you.
What do you think? I have the right to do it, but it is ethically right.
What do you think they would say? Do you think they would say that it's okay for you to know the cause and nature of the proceedings before choosing a lawyer?
I think technically they would say that I would need to know the cause and nature of the proceedings before I need a lawyer.
You don't need to, but you have the right to. Those are two different things. We know you can choose a lawyer without knowing the cause and nature. You can choose a lawyer at day one, and you can choose one before you know anything. But the question is not that. The question is, do you have the right to know the cause and nature of the proceedings and then to choose a lawyer based upon interviews using that knowledge?
Yeah, no, I understand that.
Or will they insist that you choose a lawyer in ignorance, randomly?
At this point, they're insisting I choose a lawyer.
That's not what I asked you. You got to be really, you got to match my specificity here. I'm being really, really careful with language. Do you believe that they'll make you choose a lawyer? Well, for one, do you believe that they'll make you choose a lawyer?
Make me? No.
Okay. They'll pressure you, no doubt, because it solves their problem instantly. It's very, very good for them. It is a full-on win when they get you to choose a lawyer. If they get you to choose a lawyer before informing you the cause and nature of the proceedings, a double win. If they get you to choose a lawyer instead of informing you the cause and nature of the proceedings, it's a win.
Yahtzee.
Now, the question I asked is, do you have the right to be informed of the cause and nature of the proceedings before selecting a lawyer? Before selecting a specific lawyer, or whether or not you'll have a lawyer? Or whether or not you'll plead guilty? Maybe you don't need a lawyer to plead guilty. Why would you hire a lawyer to plead guilty? You can just do that without one.
So, yes.
So, again, structuring all of this to where they don't have a way out except to trample on, quote-unquote, your rights. As if they respect that any more than I do. But it's about making clear that they have to give up their bullshit sense of justice or the truth or your conviction. One of those things has got to go out the window.
That is some gold right there. Ooh, that's some gold.
I never felt so stupid in my life, so you know it was.
Shit. That's your job, man, if you choose to do it. But you got that work ahead of you, man. That's the whole point, is constructing these things. Nothing is lost. You're at the same position everyone is at when they're at. There's people who knew all this shit ahead of time. They walk in and the judge says, listen, you're going to shut up. I'm putting in a not guilty plea for if you say a damn thing while I'm putting in this not guilty plea, I'm going to throw you in jail and still do it.
Been there, done that.
And then they walk out in exactly the same position you're in, buddy. It happens. Having to vacate not guilty pleas is almost par for the course. It's just a normal thing. Having to undo assigned lawyers and point out that they're bullshit and that you have no desire and never had any desire and never was represented by them, and that it's just the judge's wish that you be represented by him to make the prosecution's job easier is the only thing that seems to be the result of it. Not that the judge, you don't know the judge's, you know, reasonings, but the only effect it has is that it stops you from being properly informed of the cause and nature of the proceedings, and it stops you from pleading guilty easily.
Yeah, I had to get rid of 3 lawyers on my first case I caught.
Right on. Because that's one of their standard maneuvers. Throwing that guilty plea on you to make the question moot, and then throw a lawyer on you to make it to where you can't ask it again.
I started out with a public defender in a shitty office, and I ended up with a guy with like $300 brown leather awesome shoes. It was pretty sweet.
They upgraded you, huh?
Oh, they upgraded me hardcore. Yeah, it was great.
I'll be honest, right now I'm shitting bricks right now because I don't think I filed the motion right.
Wah, you can fix it.
Yeah, an honest mistake can be fixed. Especially since you're doing it right away. I mean, they didn't even address it yet, so who cares? It no harm, no foul kind of thing, right?
Okay, do I submit it or just get a copy and over to the prosecutor?
You do the thing you were supposed to do. Look that up. did you get the motion from Mark? It should already be kind of done for your area, if I remember, right? Texas shit.
I'm up in Washington.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I had it in my head you were in Texas for some reason. Probably because some joke or something. Washington State or Washington, D.C.?
State.
Oh, good.
No, not D.C.
Yeah, D.C. gets a number even more fucked up. But, nonetheless, no doubt you have to, you know, give a copy to the prosecutor, give a copy to the court. He says what else, I forget.
Man, that was a great combo.
I've got a lot ahead of me. It was, thank you.
Cool, glad it worked out. Yes, you have a lot ahead of you. That whole, you know, you're fucked. No, you're the normal amount of fucked. You're not extra fucked.
Yeah, he said that about 3 hours ago.
Right.
And I doubt he feels the same way after 3 hours, because when he said that, I was like, I can relate to that feeling, but that's so not true. You just don't know it yet, you know?
Right. Right, right. I mean, they want to make it seem like the avalanche is just coming right at you, which, I mean, again, a lot of it is true. But yeah. At the same time, there is a lot of success story.
Go ahead.
You got to compare it. Yeah, you got to compare it. Like, what is the conviction rate against public defenders in your area? You think? What do you think? What would you suspect it is?
Are we counting like plea deals as convictions?
No, against public defenders.
Yeah, the conviction rate against public defenders. And yeah, I know plea deals accounts for like 1,000,000,000% of whatever anyways, but
you mean, so like if the public defender actually tried to fight it on my behalf?
Fair enough. Court. Yeah, if it goes to trial, what's the conviction rate?
I've got no clue. I'm not sure.
Probably high 90s.
right?
High 90s. Almost as good as the plea deal percentage out of all cases.
Yeah. So the plea deal is high 90s, and then of those that make it past the plea deal into trial, high 90s, you know.
Ooh, you know what consoles...
It's like... Oh, go ahead.
You know what coincides with that, Gary? Funny percentage is if you... I looked this up. Anyone, go to your state commission on judicial conduct and look in the reports online and see how many people actually contact them to file complaints against the judges. Then they'll show you the percentage of people who actually do file the complaint because the secretaries or whoever they have to soothsayer them out of it convince the vast majority to not even file. I remember hearing the conversation. She was like, this office is actually powerless to do anything. You know, I mean, they were giving language like that. So you have a minuscule percentage, like 10% actually file. It's less than that. I'm being generous. And then out of that small percentage that actually file, it's like 2% actually result in anything against a judge. And oh, by the way, you won't even be told. It will never be a matter of public record what their punishment was and for how long. If that isn't the shit right there, you know?
Well, if you're not an anarchist, you, man.
Yeah, exactly. Combine that percentage with the one that was just discussed, and you have your answer.
Hey, they got a down pat, man. They got a whole scapegoat system of legislators and shit.
You
got
to give the devil its due. I mean, right. Respect. Shit. They have this Roman Colosseum thing down to a T. You know?
So what do you think? Okay, so do you think that people who do this shit learn it and go through it? Have, let's see, anywhere close to that kind of a shitty record? I mean, I don't know. I'll put even a mediocre level of person, their success rate versus like going with the flow. Man, I will. I don't know. I'm biased, but I do think that we fare a lot better than people who go with the public defender plea deal. Initial plea deal, let's put it that way.
I must have missed the first part of that. What was the first
part of that? I'm trying to gauge like how people generally do, like even a mediocre, I'm gonna call it player, even a mediocre study versus someone who goes with what the public defender comes up with as a plea deal.
Oh, I see.
As far as what they're serving and stuff.
Yeah. I've found that as long as you're brought down to bend the knee, they really don't come down hard on you. Rarely is the case where someone throws such a fit to anger them enough to cause some kind of a vengeful, oh yeah, well screw that guy or girl, I'm going to give him something close to the max. I've seen that rarely. It's almost as if they want to send a message in a YouTube day and age like, hey, if you eventually bend the knee, you'll be okay.
Again, a lot of our quote-unquote success is someone showing an extreme amount of competence and then getting a good plea deal.
There's a large, yeah. If you swing the sword well, even if not perfectly, you will get a better plea deal than any lawyer could ever get you. Johnny Cochran, be damned, in his grave.
Yeah. There was a guy who lives just up the street here from me. He was a real quick study, though. That motherfucker only did like a week. But he pulled up to one of those checkpoints. And he did that whole am I being detained thing. And they're like, you're not under arrest. And he said, bye, and drove off. And they fucking chased him down threw him in when he got home. And
got balls.
He does. He's a salesman, though. I mean, by nature, he was a bright salesman. But again, he's also a big black guy in kind of a whitish area. So he had that going against him. a bit, but he just knew how to talk to people, and he knew how to kind of gauge the situations and stuff. And after a little bit of kind of the wrestle, the judge just said, "I tell you what, you guys need to go out in the hall and kind of settle this." And he knew he had it. The guy's like, "How about, you know, this much time and this much money?" And he's like, "I'm not taking shit from you. I'm not paying you nothing, and I'm not going to jail for nothing."
Now, see.
And the guy's like, how about a couple hours of community service?" He's like, "Okay."
There's something to be said for that. There's something to be said for that. And that's easy coming from me, because I did that too. And with a sample size of 2, that's not much to go on. But I say this with reluctance. If you just go balls to the wall and direct eye contact, no matter what comes out of it, just say, in essence, "I don't believe it. I don't buy it. I'm never going to buy it. If you put a gun to my head, I wouldn't buy it. Screw all of you. Give me my jury. Blah, 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 blah. Jurisdiction, blah, blah, blah." They throw a plea deal.
Well, with the jury. Yeah. Just to say, this problem doesn't go away.
Yeah.
You're going to be fighting me for months to even get to a jury.
Yes. Because
on this. Yeah.
I humbly, humbly believe, with very little evidence, that they rely on the fear bluff. The fear bluff. And if you can beat the fear bluff effectively enough, they put you in a category of, uh-oh, that type of thing. But it takes all. I mean, you have to be in a position where you don't have like a wife and a kid and responsibilities and a job and blah. You know what I mean?
It's not really a fear bluff, and it's just a fear. And then yes, we're going to do that.
Okay, to me, that's a fear bluff. They say, "Oh yeah, we're going to do that. Call that bluff." With direct eye contact, talking jurisdiction about how you're going to turn their prison into a snow globe of motions to dismiss because of the factual lack of evidence of jurisdiction.
Now, say it to them. Keep in mind, due process violations are still a thing. They still make them look bad when they kind of really go too far. I mean, if that's all they got, sometimes they'll reach to it, but... Man, there's a certain amount that sometimes is bluff and a certain amount that's not.
If you can swing it, then you can. If you can't, then don't, because it's all about minimizing the damage. But I don't know. They have their limits.
Well, one thing I've learned here tonight is I definitely need to get sharper on what means what.
Well, mission accomplished after 2 hours of Gary or however long it's been.
Thanks for taking the time, man. I really appreciate it.
That's cool. It's been a while since we've done one.
Scratch your claws well on that post, Gary.
It's been a while. See, now he's going to be listening to some other, you know, marathon thing where we did it with somebody else, and he's like, "Man, he did that so much better on that dude. What the hell? I got the shaft."
I listen to everything. Everything's got something a little different in it to offer.
Man, I love those people, though, that come up, like you say, the big black guy. By the way, how long ago was that? Because in this day and age, that might be an advantage. You know what I'm saying?
This was, oh man, he was probably 3 years ago? 4 maybe? Shit, man, I don't know. I lose track of time.
That might be enough, Gary. The last 3 or 4 years? Last 2 or 3 years? You know?
Yeah, because he used to kind of, you know, pop in once in a while, play around with somebody a little bit. I could still get in touch with him and pull him in if there was something going on around. But he kind of got into multi-level marketing crap that he was doing. So I might have ditched him on Facebook. I don't remember.
Interesting.
Or maybe I hit him because, you know, I was tired of the whatever, you know, jelly juice or whatever the fuck he was selling. I don't know.
Yeah. Oh, God, yeah.
Not necessarily that, but same difference, yeah. You know?
I mean, maybe I'm not biased, but my sample size is skewed because I've watched a lot of border control checkpoints, and they always stop and it's, you know, "Hey, are you a U.S. citizen?" And very few of them are like, "Nope, take off." You know, they just, "Where's my secondary parking point?" And then they waste a half hour to an hour of their time while they don't admit or confess or whatever you want to call it to be a citizen. And then they let them go. It's all over YouTube. If you just resist long enough at these border controlled checkpoints, they will let you go. Don't believe me. Look it up on YouTube. There's yeah, compilations of that.
If you're willing to put in the time, you can outlast them.
But you got to know your stuff. And how long, if you were...
Well, it doesn't hurt to be just a white dude either.
Well, of course, of course. Speaking perfect English, of course.
Right.
But if you're willing to put in the time for just, let's say, a month of just hardcore... Just a month. I mean, I was after it for 3 to 4 before I really got a grasp of it. But just a month. Gosh, you could pass your way through a border control checkpoint.
When you say a month, are you talking about a month just studying or just practicing the verbiage with another person?
No. Not just with any other person. Like here, role-playing, seeking, questioning, practicing. There's no easy way out. You have to be, I am going to learn this. I will beat these people. You have to be dedicated in that kind of way. You have to be naturally motivated in that way. You can't be like, hey, as soon as, I mean, internally, you can't be like, hey, as soon as this is over, I'm going to get back to my life and forget all this stuff. Those people don't make it. You have to have something inside or whatever that just goes, F it. No. That's just my humble opinion. If you're that way, if you're oriented that way, they detect that. They see that. They see that in the public behind you. They see that online. God damn. If you got a YouTube channel and some support behind it and you let them know, just my humble opinion. It's all about public and political pressure.
What do you think he'll do if you ask him, do I have the right to plead guilty here today?
Probably say something to the fact that, yes, you do, but I wouldn't advise it. You probably should talk to an attorney.
Great. Do I have the right to make an informed plea of guilty here today?
Yes, you do. We don't accept pleas that aren't informed.
All right. Now let's switch it around, dude. You answer yourself.
What's the next step? The judges said to you, yes, we only have informed pleas in this courtroom here today. What's your next step?
Do you have the sheet in front of you? Don't forget it.
Am I presumed innocent?
You're presumed innocent until proven guilty.
Am I presumed innocent of all elements of the charges?
I don't know what you mean.
You just asked, am I presumed innocent of all the charges? And the judge just said, I don't know what you mean. And you're hesitating? Hey, judge, am I presumed innocent of all the charges? And the judge says, I don't know what you mean. And you're hesitating.
So you don't know what I mean by that? I'm having trouble translating to a yes or no question.
Well, you just gave one, but... The judge is playing coy with you. He's trying to manipulate you. He's feigning ignorance and stupidity. And that will happen. So you have to be willing to, hopefully with very little hesitation, make him pay for it. Are you telling me that you don't know blankety blank? Calm face. Direct eye contact. Hands out of your pockets at your side.
That's my initial instinct is to ask that.
Okay, well then ask it.
I don't know how to do it without sounding like an asshole or just...
You're afraid of sounding like a quote-unquote asshole in a courtroom of contention with parasites like this? It might get contentious. You're aware, right?
It's no, going to get contentious.
Okay.
So to get the Columbo persona as best as possible.
Okay, fair enough. So then get Socratic. So what did I say?
You don't understand. Let's see here. You don't understand what I mean by innocent of all the elements of the charge.
Okay, so are you saying to this courtroom on the record that you don't understand what an element is of the charge? Yes or no?
And see, this is where I'm saying I'm not quite there yet, because I'm sure he wouldn't just say, yeah.
Well, he wouldn't,
because, yeah. I just don't know what you mean by that.
Of all the elements of the charges, is this, I mean, I wouldn't explain it to him.
No, he's calling you into question, thinking you'll mean something kind of stupid by it. Like, you won't mean the normal thing.
If I give you my meaning. Yeah. Go ahead, Gary, sorry.
Oh, yeah. Same principle as we've been going through. He wouldn't do it to the prosecutor. He wouldn't keep asking the prosecutor what mundane shit means. And he wouldn't take your definition even if you gave it to him to mean, you know, to be, like, binding on everything that was said.
So I would respond with, well, what do you mean by... What is your understanding
of it? Well, kind of. Okay, so you're trying... Keep in mind your goal is to figure out what you're accused of, right? You're trying to dig at details about your accusation, right?
Right.
So, okay, if you're trying not to be so asshole-ish, it's like, I'm just trying to figure out the cause and nature of these proceedings. In that... Is jurisdiction one of the elements of what I'm accused of? Is it the word elements that's giving you pause, or is it the word jurisdiction that's giving you pause, or something else? You know, you could just back up and say, what part of this English is trouble, you know? Or you could just back up and say, did I stutter, bitch? No.
did I stutter, bitch?
No.
And that is literally my natural inclination, but sorry, I'm just going against everything that every...
Yeah, he's trying to be coy and throw you off, though, because he knows you're unlikely to fucking challenge him on that. He's like, what are you acting stupid? He's acting stupid because he can get away with it. Because you probably won't call him stupid.
If your definitions have no power in this courtroom, what good is it to give your definitions? What good is it? Why is he even asking for it? The only thing that matters, because of the guns in the room transition, is what his opinion of this is. If he's going to play the prosecutor's role, then okay. Give the definition of this legal term. And then we'll challenge it.
Yeah. Yeah. And you can back up and say, I'm sorry, just to be clear, has the prosecutor not asserted that this court has jurisdiction? Yes, he has. You know, obviously. I was like, okay, is that jurisdiction an element of what he's accused me of being guilty of? Can I be guilty if there is no jurisdiction? See, do you know what an element... By the way, do you know what an element is?
I do.
Okay, cool.
I don't know. Define it. What is an element? Not that I don't believe you. I just want to make sure that it encompasses the entirety of the legalese version. Go ahead.
Yep. Let's see. An element would be one singular part of a whole. So you have to have each one of these parts in order to make up a whole this.
What if there are 20 elements and you have 18 of them? What does that mean?
Then you don't have this. You have 18 elements in order to 18 elements of that, but you don't have that.
Okay. Do you have that if there are only 18 of 20?
No.
Okay. So if even one element is missing, then what do you have?
Dick.
How do you? Great answer. So how would you address that to a courtroom? Because they're missing the element of jurisdiction, obviously. So.
And I'm playing with a koi judge who doesn't know what elements are?
No, you're playing with a court judge who knows exactly what elements are. He's testing you because he thinks you're dumb, and he's trying to manipulate the hell out of you.
He thinks you're reading something from a script that you got online, which is true enough, but he also thinks you don't understand it.
I know he's smarter than you and can out-manipulate you, and that he'll go on collecting his $125,000 to $250,000 annual salary a year. Which comes down to about $500 per working day, more or less.
So where were we?
So what does jurisdiction mean to you?
Am I the judge again?
No, you're the defendant. What does jurisdiction mean to you?
Are you going to take my definition of jurisdiction and apply it here today?
I don't know what you mean by that.
Do you honestly not know what an element is?
I know what an element is. I never said I didn't. We're here for an arraignment. I'm tired of wasting the court's time. You're here to plead guilty, not guilty, or no contest. How do you plead?
Is jurisdiction part of the charge?
Do you have a lawyer, sir?
Why did you change your phrasing?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
All right, just trying to get rid of the word element.
No, why? You asked a perfectly good question. He fought you on it, and you made it a shitty question. Why did you do so? So every time he doesn't like a question in the future, all he's got to do is fuck with you a little bit, and you'll make it a shitty question?
Seems like it right now. I don't know. I guess because I'm usually trying to get answers from people.
Yeah, this is a common scenario the judge is going to paint for you.
Very common.
You know, just put you up shit creek and let you fucking make a shitty raft.
Put you up shit creek and make you a shitty raft. I don't know. With bullshit oars.
Gary. You've got to own the SV. No,
you got cardboard oars. Good luck. And a river of bullshit.
So aside from... asking if he's serious about whether or not he does not know what an element is.
Well, there's a million approaches to this, if that's where you're going.
Yeah.
We're just trying to get you to start experimenting and exercising how to approach an unsolvable kind of problem. I mean, it has solutions, but, you know, one that you don't know how to get out of yet. And sometimes the only way out is to piss him off a little bit.
Amen to
there
that.
There is no zero risk out to the scenario. Other than to abandon it and just give up on that point. Which is exactly what he wants to leave you with.
Man, I'm telling you, there are points to be scored outside of any awesome Gary-type words you could say by standing there and staring at the judge. I'm just saying, the non-verbals matter. The non-verbals matter. So how would you define jurisdiction? What do you mean by jurisdiction?
I don't believe it matters how I define jurisdiction. I'm looking for how you define jurisdiction.
No. Judge's definition isn't really important either.
Yeah, that's too specific.
Are we relying on my definition of jurisdiction?
Closer, but not quite.
Does the prosecutor's accusation reference my definition of jurisdiction?
Oh, damn, that's on the bullseye right there. Damn, that's some bullseye shit right there.
That's why you're the man.
It's a perspective, man. That's what I'm getting at. It's a perspective. It's a keep your eye on what you're asking about. You're asking about the prosecutor's assertion.
Yeah, I'm having a hard time getting my head into that perspective.
That's the point to roleplay. Your head slowly gets into it. And the right level of sarcasm and forked-tongueness.
And thick skin will lead you to the promised land if you're so dedicated.
So where are we at? What's my definition of jurisdiction? Is that what I was asked?
Sure, why not?
It was, I mean, basically it was the judge saying, I don't understand you. I don't speak English, sorry. I forgot how to English.
Fuck, man, my brain is... I don't know what to say, man.
Okay, well, if it happens here, it's going to happen in a courtroom. So suck it up and recenter and focus and say something. Take your time, though. There's no rush here. I'd rather the right words come out of your mouth than the wrong words after a long time. No rush. No time rush. What do you mean by jurisdiction?
Is my definition of jurisdiction going to be the one that we're relying on here today?
That wasn't bad, Gary. That wasn't bad.
I'm not at all.
That wasn't bad.
No objections.
Well, of course not. I assure you, this court has jurisdiction. If you'd like to challenge jurisdiction, you could do so at trial. But first, you'd have to enter a plea of not guilty. Would you like to enter a plea of not guilty? I'm not giving you legal advice.
Oh, I don't want to challenge the jurisdiction. I would just like to see if there's evidence.
Oh, really?
Whoa!
Oh, really? Damn, dude.
Thank you. All right, then we'll just go ahead and enter the plea of not guilty.
Why not? You just got done challenging jurisdiction and then said, I'm not going to challenge jurisdiction. What the fuck was that? Sorry, excuse my language.
Examine. Excuse me. I'm sorry.
Well, okay, what'd you mean to say?
We're not testing jurisdiction. I just want to see that there is evidence there is some.
All right. Well, that's a little esoteric, but okay.
Yeah, testing.
Just say it, retarded.
Well, just stick to the being informed kind of perspective might be a little clearer. Like, I'm just trying to get information at this point. You're purely in investigative phase.
Common English. No legalese expectation. Common English.
So, are there elements to this charge?
Well, that's a stupid question.
Yeah, at this
you already point. Know the answer. Don't ask questions you already know the answer to. It's considered wasting time. And then, if I'm a judge and you've got me kind of already uncomfortable, and you ask a time waster, I will let that fester. I will let it sit and let it be the last question you ask because it's obviously a time waster. I'll schedule trial. I'll just let it sit. I'll have a conversation with the other side for a little while. I'll let that sit and fester in the record a little while, and then I'll go ahead and execute on it. You know,
That's the truth. That's the truth.
Because your job is to have a relevant and unanswered question on the table at all times, almost like a game.
At all times, catch 22.
And his job is to try to get it to look like you abandon your question. Or you have to take care of your question, one or the other.
Voluntarily, might I add, voluntarily, not by coercion.
Yeah. Well, sometimes they push that line a little bit, but yeah.
Okay, I'm still responding to you guys, the judge not knowing what I mean by elements, correct?
Fair enough. If you feel like responding to that, come up with a good way.
This guy's doing well. We're both beating the shit out of him. He's doing well.
Yeah.
Good on him. Good on him.
Yeah.
Keep at it, man. Keep at it.
Yeah,
exactly. Keep at it. Keep at it. You're doing well, man. Go ahead.
I got to pee so bad, let me tell you.
Go pee. Go pee.
Give me a second. Talk some shit about me while I'm gone. I'll be right back.
Man, this guy's such a loser. What are we wasting our time on this fool for?
All he does is pee.
I know. Past your bedtime.
It is. I was up late last night. Well, I slept through the day for some reason. Yeah, yesterday or whatever it was. So it kind of screwed up my whole sleep schedule. And tomorrow I work from home again. So I just go over to mom's.
Yay. I'm so happy to hear that. Yay. You're going home. Yay.
I went to work today. I actually went in. I went Thursday, Friday, and today, so.
Nice. I love to hear that, man. I love to hear that. Change of schedule.
Yeah. Much easier.
Yeah,
my diet is improved. I can't say that.
That was a dope transition, Gary. Out of the blue, you're like, hey, check this out. I'm going here. I'm like, awesome. Hey, check this out. It's amazing. Like, awesome. Hey, check this out. Lifestyle is so much better. And check all these benefits out. I'm like, wow. And then you come back. I'm like, yeah, I let my boss know that what's up. I'm like, great. And it was just, it was like good news after good news after good news after good news.
Some of the other owners expressed that they're not happy with me working from home. It's mainly because... Yeah, it's mainly because they wanted to be able to bother me.
Yeah, you know, quick
answers and shit.
As they will.
Yeah, yeah. Well, they don't have a real argument, though, because there's a guy there who's there for those questions, and if it goes beyond his ability, he comes to me. But they like going straight to me instead, you know.
Amen to that, man. Sounds ideal. It was such good news last 3 months. Such good news. Such good news.
Yeah, well... Again, it's a big strength in not needing them, you know. When a job gets the idea that you don't care much about them, but when as long as they still need you a bit.
True that.
All right, I'm back. I'm going to have to give up the computer line here in about 15 minutes, though, fellas.
Right on.
How dare you?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, man. Trust me, we had a better conversation than if I was at home with my 5-year-old and my 5-month-old. We're getting a little bit more done, even though it's next to nothing.
Oh, it's next to a lot. It's next to a lot.
Well, I'm still on number three. And...
So just to give you some perspective on this, do I have the right to plead guilty kind of thing? I don't know what the current record is, but I do remember there was a gal in England, Helen, who did this a total of 18 times, I think. Like, they kept insisting that they put in a plea for her, and she'd go back and she'd be like this, and then they'd just go say, well, what is your plea then? You know, 18 times. And, incidentally, the final resolution of her case was that they awarded her damages for the prosecutor dragging her through court, which probably never got collected, but still, officially, she got awarded.
Nice, nice.
See, I know the plan. I just need to get better at submitting questions as answers. Relevant questions as answers.
Yeah. You also have to keep in mind, to actually phrase them as questions and try to get them as yes-nos if you can. Did you catch why the yes or no question is kind of the best question?
Well, for clarity, I assume.
Well, for one, it's easy to tell if they answered it. Was that a yes or was that a no? Because if they give you a big old speech as an answer, and they say, I did, because no matter what question they don't answer, they'll say they answered it. And if you can say, well, if you answered it, I'm still trying to figure out if it was a yes or a no answer to my question.
If I didn't ask him if that was a no, or I didn't say, so that's a no.
I'm sorry, you said, so that's a no?
Said, so on the right to a fair and meaningful hearing, you're saying that's a no?
So that's a statement, not a question. I know you went up at the end, but that wasn't the question, right? Do you understand that that is completely nonsense to say?
I absolutely
on the record it says, so that is a no, period. And he doesn't have to respond to that. He can leave you wallow in your mistakes. He's not obligated to correct your your mistake. Mispresumption.
Okay.
Yeah, you're in an official, you're in a formal conversation, so all those little manipulative tricks that we use in our normal conversations don't go.
Mitzel, I have a question for you. Do you know what a leading question is?
It's a question where you're trying to solicit the answer that you want.
It's a question with the answer in the question. So basically, you're on the right path. That's basically the mindset that you're in when you're asking the question or when you're clarifying what the judge is saying. You're trying to put it in the form of a leading question.
Point of order, you're clarifying what the prosecutor is saying, technically. Even if it's coming through the judge.
So watch a few videos on leading questions and it'll get you into the mindset of how to form the question so you can think about it quicker.
Okay.
Be careful of what videos you watch about leading questions, because some of those videos about leading questions are from the state. That's a true statement.